I've half a mind to register an oath that I'll never have my hair cut again. And I was particularly emphatic in my instructions to the hairdresser only to cut the ends off. He must have thought I meant the other ends. Never mind, I shan't meet anybody to care about so early. Whew, 8 o'clock. I declare I haven't a moment to lose. Fate has placed me with the most punctual, particular and peremptory of hatters, and I must fulfill my destiny. Open locks, whoever knocks.
Good morning, Colonel Cox. I hope you slept comfortably, Colonel.
I can't say I did, Bouncer. I should feel obliged to you if you could accommodate me with a more protuberant bolster, Bouncer. The one I've got seems to me to have about a handful and a half of feathers at each end and nothing whatever in the middle.
Anything to accommodate you, Captain Cox.
Thank you. Then perhaps you will be good enough to hold this glass while I finish my toilet.
Certainly. Why, I do declare, you've had your hair cut.
Cut. It strikes me I've had it mowed. It is very kind of you to mention it, but I'm sufficiently conscious of the absurdity of my personal appearance already. As if I've been cropped for the militia.
The militia. I recollect when I was in the militia.
Ah, now, she's off on her hobby.
Yes, we were mounted on chargers. I recollect one occasion being seated firmly in my saddle for 8 hours. And I don't recollect being able to sit down again firmly for a considerable period afterwards.
Rat a plan, rat a plan, rat a plan, rat a plan, rat a plan.
This is pleasant. This comes of having one's hair cut. None of my hats will fit me. Ah, never mind. This one appears to me to wobble a bit less than the others. And now I'm off. Ah, by the by, bouncer, I wish to know, how is it that I frequently find my apartment full of smoke?
Why, I suppose the chimney.
The chimney doesn't smoke tobacco. I'm speaking of tobacco smoke. How is that?
Why, I suppose. Yes, that must be it.
At present, I am entirely of your opinion, because I haven't the most distant particle of an idea what you mean.
Why, the gentleman who has got the attics is hardly ever without a pipe in his mouth, and there he sits for hours and puffs away into the fireplace.
Ah, then you mean to say that this gentleman's smoke, instead of emulating the example of all other sorts of smoke and going up the chimney, thinks proper to affect a singularity by taking the contrary direction?
Why?
Then I suppose the gentleman you are speaking of is the same individual that I invariably meet coming upstairs when I'm going down, and going down when I'm coming up.
Why, yes,
From the appearance of his outward man, I should unhesitatingly set him down as a gentleman connected with the printing interest.
Yes, sir, and a very respectable young gentleman he is. Good morning, Colonel.
Stay, bouncer, stay. To me it has occurred that now's the time with you to have a word.
What can he mean? I tremble.
Listen.
With pleasure. Yes, I must assemble.
That two are two. Arithmetic. And only one remains. Take one from one, and as we have been taught, remainder none. That is, remainder not. Take one from two, take one from one, take one from one, and as we have been taught, remainder none. Remainder none, that is, remain.
Anna.
Now causes calls, as sure as eggs this eggs. Calls haven't souls, no more than they have legs. But as you will admit, the case is so. Legs are no legs, my calls contrive to go. Contrive to go. As you will admit, the case is so, that legs or no legs, my calls contrive to go, contrive to go.
Well, I should say, or as it seems to me.
Exactly.
Quite so.
Then we both agree.
As we agree.
I've something more to say. Tis not my calls alone.
Oh, why this cruel tone?
But other things as dear as they to me, which in that little closet I carefully deposit. In them a sure and gradual loss they see. Until the case the poets won't express. By degrees and beautifully less. Until the case the poet's words express. Small by degrees and beautifully less. Small by degrees and beautifully less.
Beautifully, beautifully,
beautifully less. And now, Sergeant Johnson, I beg to run down so far. Never was occasion.
At a newspaper office all night and doesn't come home to the morning, And Mr. Cox is busy making acts all day long and doesn't come home till night. So that I'm getting double rent for my room and neither of my lodgers are any the wiser for it. It was a happy thought of mine that it was. But I must work quickly. First, I must put Mr. Cox's things out of Mr. Box's way. Then I always put the key where Mr. Cox can find it. And then I make the bed. And I always need to remember that the head of the bed for Colonel Cox becomes the foot of the bed for Private Box. People's tastes differ so, but I haven't an instant to lose.
Sir, why don't you keep to your own side of the staircase, sir?
Lord, Mr. Box, what is the matter?
Mind your own business, bouncer.
Dear, dear, Mr. Box, what a timber you are in. To be sure, I declare you are quite pale in the face. Oh,
what color would you have a man to be who has been setting up all night long, setting letters for the daily paper?
But then you've got all day off.
Oh, so it seems. Far be it from me, bouncer, to hurry your movements, but I think it right to acquaint you with my immediate intention of divesting myself of my garments and going to bed.
Certainly, Mr. Box.
Stop. Can you inform me who the individual is that I invariably encounter going down the stairs when I'm coming up and coming up the stairs when I'm going down?
Oh. Yes, the gentleman in the attic, sir.
Oh. But there's nothing particularly remarkable about him except that, well, his hats. I meet him in all sorts of hats. White hats and black hats and hats with broad brims and hats with narrow brims. Hats with naps and hats without naps. In short, I have come to the conclusion that he must be individually and professionally associated with the, the hatting interest.
Yes, sir. And they tell me that's why he took the hattics. And by the by, Mr. Box, he begged me to request of you as a particular favor that you would not smoke quite so much.
Oh, did he? Then you may tell the gentleman hatter, with my compliments, that if he objects to the effluvia of tobacco, he had better domesticate himself in some adjoining parish.
You surely wouldn't deprive me of a lodger.
Oh, it would come to the precisely same thing, bouncer, because if I detect the slightest attempt to put my pipe out, I at once give you warning that I shall give you warning at once.
Well, Mr. Box, do you want anything else of me?
Oh, on the contrary, I've had quite enough of you.
Well, if I ever.
Oh, but there's one evolution I should much like to see you perform.
What's that?
Right about face, quick march! Now, let me see. Shall I take my nap before I swallow my breakfast? Or shall I take my breakfast before I swallow my nap? Shall I swallow my nap before I... Never mind. I've got a rasher of bacon around here somewhere. I have the most distinct and vivid recollection of having purchased a rasher of bacon. Here it is. Oh! And a penny roll. Yes. Yeah, now. Let's see. The next thing is to light the fire. Yes, where are the lucifers? Oh, here they are. What? Now, upon my life. This is too bad, Bouncer. This is by several degrees too bad. I had a whole box. And 3 days ago, and now there's only one. I'm perfectly aware that he purloins my coals and my candles and my sugar. But I did think, that my lucifers were sacred. Bouncer has been using my gridiron! Oh, the last article of consumption I cooked on this gridiron was a pork chop. And now it powerfully impregnated with the odor of red herrings. How sleepy I am, to be sure. I'd indulge myself in a nap if there was anyone to superintend the turning of my bacon. Perhaps it will turn itself.
Hushed is the bacon on the grid. I'll take a nap and close my eye. Soon shall I be nodding.
Master is punctual, always in business. Unpunctuality, even slight, is in his eyes such a crime that on showing my fizz in his shop, I thought there'd be the devil to pay. Oh, I thought there'd be the devil to pay. Employer with his physiognomy shining from soap like a star in astronomy said, Mr. Cox, you'll oblige me and honor me if you will take this as your holiday. If you will take this as your holiday. Already the squash I feel, fearing the rain, put on my Macintosh I will. Now for my breakfast, my light déjeuner. Now for my breakfast, my light déjeuner. I bought a mutton chop, so I shan't want any dinner. Good gracious, I forgot the bread. Hello, what's this? Oh, a roll, I declare. Come, that's lucky. Now then, to light the fire. Hello, who presumes to touch my box of lucifers? Why, it's empty. I left one in it. I'll take my oath I did. Hey, day, why the fire is lighted? Where's the gridiron? On the fire, I declare, and what's that on it? Bacon? Bacon it is. Well, now, upon my life, there's a quiet coolness about Bounce's proceedings that's almost amusing. She takes my last lucifer, my coals, and my gridiron to cook her breakfast by. No, no, I can't stand this. Come out of that. Now then for my breakfast things.
Come in if it's you, Bouncer. You needn't be afraid.
I wonder how long I've been asleep.
Goodness gracious, my bacon!
Hello, what's this? A chop?
Whose chop? Bouncers all be bound.
He thought to cook his breakfast while I was sleeping. But where's my bacon? There it is. Oh, upon my life, Bouncer's going at it. Oh, shall I curb my indignation? Shall I falter in my vengeance? No. So much for Bouncer's breakfast. Now for my own. I may as well lay my breakfast things. Oh, yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. There we go. And it's all penny roll. I like that.
Come in, come in. Oh, goodness, my chop. Hello, what's this? The bacon again? Oh, poo! Confound it! I can't stand it!
Who are you, sir? Tell me who. If it comes to that, sir, who are you?
Who are you, sir?
What's that to you, sir?
What's that to who, sir?
Who, sir? You, sir?
Who are you, sir?
Who are you, sir?
Tell me who, sir?
Tell me who, sir?
Who are you,
who are you, sir?
Tell me who,
sir? Who are you, sir?
Tell me who,
sir?
Who are you, sir?
Yes, 'tis the printer.
Yes, 'tis the hatter.
Yes, 'tis the
Printer, take a printer, 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 patter,
patter, patter, cease your patter,
go.
Patter, patter, cease your patter, 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 cease your patter, 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 patter,
take a patter,
go. Patter, patter, cease your patter, 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 cease your patter, 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 patter,
take a
patter, go. Patter, patter,
take a
patter,
patter, take a
patter, go.
Comes to that, sir. Here is me.
Murder comes, so
he can settle the hatter.
Turn out the man.
Bouncer,
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 bouncer.
Rataplan, 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 rataplan.
Rataplan, rataplan.
Immediately turn out that printer.
Well, but gentlemen...
Explain!
Explain. Whose room is this?
Whose room is this?
Doesn't it belong to me?
No.
There. You hear, sir? It belongs to me.
No. It belongs to both of you.
Both of us?
Oh, yes. Gents, don't be angry. But you see, this gentleman only being at home in the daytime, and that gentleman at night, I thought I might venture until my little back second floor room was ready.
When will your little back second floor room be ready?
Tomorrow.
I'll take it.
So will I.
Excuse me, but if you both take it, you may just as well stop where you are.
True.
I spoke first, sir.
With all my heart, sir, the little back second floor room is yours. Now go!
Go?
Now don't quarrel, gentlemen. You see, there used to be a partition here.
Then put it up!
No, I'll see if I can't get the other room ready this very day. Now, gents and officers, don't fight. But keep your tempers.
What a disgusting position.
Will you allow me to observe? If you have not had any exercise today, you'd better go out and take it.
I shall do nothing of the sort, sir.
Oh, very well.
Very well, sir. However, don't let me prevent you from going out.
Oh, don't flatter yourself, sir. Hello, that's my role, sir.
Hello, what are you about, sir?
What am I about? I'm about to smoke. Oh, hello, put down that window,
then
sir.
Then put your pipe out, sir.
It's not a pipe.
There.
I shall retire to my pillow.
I beg your pardon, sir. I cannot allow anyone to rumple my bed.
Your bed? Hark ye, sir. Can you fight?
No, sir.
No? Then come on!
Calm down, sir, or I'll instantly vociferate police!
Well, sir, although we are doomed to occupy the same room for a few hours longer, I don't see any necessity in our cutting each other's throats, sir.
Not at all. It's an operation that I should decidedly object to.
And after all, I've no violent animosity against you, sir.
Nor have I any rooted antipathy to you, sir.
Oh, besides, it was all Bouncer's fault, sir.
Entirely, sir.
Very well, sir.
Very well, sir.
Take a bit of roll, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Do you sing, sir?
I sometimes dabble in a serenade.
Oh, then babble away.
The buttercup dwells on the lowly mead. The daisy is bright to see, but brighter far are the eyes that read the thoughts in the heart of me. I come by night, I come by day, I come in the morn to sing my lay. I know my notes, I count each bar, and I've learned a tune on the gay guitar.
Fiddle diddle dum, fiddle diddle dum.
This month's Bradshaw, sir. time. Life?
No, sir.
People? Entertainment Weekly?
My wife wouldn't let me.
Your
that wife? That is, my intended wife.
It's the same thing. I congratulate you.
Thank you. You needn't disturb yourself, sir. She won't come here.
Oh, I understand. You've got a snug little establishment here of your own. On the sly, you cunning dog.
No such thing, sir. I repeat, no such thing, sir. But my wife, I mean my intended wife, happens to be the proprietor of a considerable number of bathing machines.
Where?
At a favorite watering place. How curious you are.
Not at all. Well?
Consequently, in the bathing season, which luckily is rather a long one, we see but little of each other. But as that is now over, I am daily indulging in the expectation of being blessed with the sight of my beloved. Are you married?
Oh, me? Why, not exactly.
Ah, a happy bachelor.
not precisely.
Oh, a widower?
Not absolutely.
You'll excuse me, sir, but at present, I don't understand how you can help being one of the three.
Not help it?
No, sir. Not to you, nor any other man alive.
Oh, that may be, but I'm not alive.
You'll excuse me, sir, but I don't like joking upon such subjects.
But I'm perfectly serious. I have been deceased these 3 years.
Will you be quiet, sir?
If you won't believe me, I'll refer you to a very large, numerous, and respectable circle of disconsolate friends. Listen.
Long ago it was my fate to captivate a widow at Ramsgate.
I, 'tis odd to state, the same at Margate did. Oh,
by her not liking to be kissed, I thought I'd better try to. In the lifeguards or blues enlist.
How odd, and so did I too.
I was not tall enough, they said.
Too short, they said of me.
The infantry I entered.
I the infantry.
My widow offered to purchase my discharge from the marching line. Oh,
that's odd, coincidentally, the very same did mine. Oh,
and hesitated to consent, for my consent she waited. I gave it.
Or with mine I went. And never hesitated.
The happy day came near at length. We hoped it would be sunny. I found I needed all my strength to face the ceremony. I suddenly found out I was unworthy to possess her. I told her so at once because I feared it might distress her. Before the words were out of my mouth, there came from the north and flew to the south a something that came unpleasantly near. Clattering, spattering, battering, shattering, dashing, clashing, smashing, flashing, slashing, crashing, missing but whizzing right past my ear. It shattered itself on the mantelpiece. Whop!
What was it?
A tremble! The basin called slop. It fell at my feet. It would have put the back of a man who was ever so meek up. So being thus baited, I retaliated and hurled at my widow a crockery teacup.
Then there was a fraction.
And I was threatened with an action.
Au ciel, proceed.
One morn, when I had finished my ablution, I took
a walk.
No, sir, a resolution. Friends or foes, none suppose, nobody knows what I does. I tie up my clothes, my shirt and my hose, my socks, I think of my woes and another woes. I pack up my bundle and off I go.
Ha! I see you left in a tiff.
Listen. I solemnly walked to the cliff, and singing a sort of a dulcet dirge, put down my bundle upon the verge, heard the wild seagull's mournful cry. Looked all around, there was nobody nigh, none but I on the cliff, so high, and all save the sea was bare and dry. And I took one look at the wave below, and I raised my hands in an agony throe, and I stood on the edge of the rock, so steep. And I gazed like a maniac on the deep. I cried, farewell, farewell to earth. Farewell, farewell to the land of my birth. Farewell, farewell to my only love, to the sea below and the sky above. With a glance at the sea of wild despair, I cried, I come! My bundle lay there, on the edge where the Coast Guard's way was chalked. Then away! In the opposite way I walked.
What a clever man, what a capital plan. I've listened with attention. I think that I should like to try your wonderful invention. What a clever man, what a capital plan. You've listened with attention. If you like it, I should like to try my wonderful invention.
Dear me, I think I begin to have some slight perception of your meaning. Ingenious creature, you disappeared. The suit of clothes was found.
Exactly, and in one of the pockets of the coat or the waistcoat or the pantaloons, I can't remember, I forget which, there was also found a piece of paper with these affecting farewell words. This is thy work, Penelope Ann.
Penelope Ann? Penelope Ann?
Penelope Ann.
Originally widow of William Wiggins?
Widow of William Wiggins.
Proprietor of bathing
machines? Proprietor of bathing machines.
At Marsgate?
Ramgate?
It must be she. And you, sir, you are Box. The lamented, long-lost Box.
I am.
And I was about to marry the interesting creature you so cruelly deceived.
Oh. Then you are Cox.
I am.
I heard of you. I congratulate you. I give you joy. And now I think I'll take that stroll.
No, you don't. I'll not lose sight of you till I restored you to the arms of your intended.
My intended? You mean your intended?
No, sir. Yours.
How could she be my intended now that I am drowned?
You're no such thing, sir. I give her up to
you. Benevolent being, I wouldn't rob you for the world. Good morning, sir.
Stop!
Oh, I warn you, Hatter, or I shall cast off the lamb and assume the lion.
Pooh!
An insult to my very face, under my very nose. You know the consequences, sir. Instant satisfaction.
With all my heart, sir. Bouncer!
Bouncer!
What is it, gentlemen?
Pistols for two.
Yes, sir.
Stop! You don't mean to say, thoughtless and misguided militiaman, do you keep loaded firearms in the house?
Oh no, they're not loaded.
Oh. Then produce the murderous weapons instantly.
Oh. I say, sir.
Well, sir.
What's your opinion of dueling, sir?
I think it's a barbarous practice, sir. Oh.
So do I, sir, to be sure. I don't so much object to it when the pistols are not loaded.
No, I dare say that does make some difference.
And yet, sir, on the other hand, doesn't it seem rather waste of time for two people to keep firing pistols at one another when there's nothing in them?
No, sir. No more than any other harmless recreation.
Hockey, why do you object to Mary Penelope Ann?
Because, as I've already observed, I can't abide her. You'll be happy with her.
Me, happy? With the consciousness that I have deprived you of such a treasure? No, Cox, no. No, 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 no.
Don't think of me, Box. I shall be sufficiently rewarded by the knowledge of my Box's happiness.
Oh, don't be absurd, sir.
Then don't you be ridiculous, sir.
I have it. Suppose we toss for the lady.
With all my heart.
Where's my tossing sixpence?
Where's my lucky shilling?
Where's my lucky sixpence?
Now then, sir, heads win?
Or tails lose? Whichever you prefer.
It's all the same to me, sir.
Very well, sir. Heads, I win. Tails, you lose.
Yes. Oh, no, no, no. Heads win, sir.
Very well. Go on. Head.
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 Couldn't you say something else instead?
Head.
Head?
I wish an occasional tail you'd try.
Head.
Head.
Head. I nail your sixpence. Hello, it's got no tail. I've a mind to pitch you out on the leads.
Your shilling, I find, has got two heads.
You swindler, you cheat, take care of my feet. Out of my room, sir, and into the street. Turn me out, try it, that is, if you can. Swindler, cheat, vagabond, swindler, cheat. You swindler,
cheat,
vagabond,
thief.
You swindler,
cheat,
vagabond,
thief.
Bouncer.
Second floor room ready?
Not quite, gentlemen. And I can't find the pistols, but I have brought you a letter. It came by the general post yesterday. I am sure I don't know how I came to forget it, for I put it carefully in me pocket.
And you've kept it carefully in your pocket ever since.
Yes, sir. I hope you'll forgive me, sir. By the boy, I paid tuppence for it.
Did you? Then I do forgive you. Margate. The postmark decidedly says Margate.
Oh, doubtless a tender epistle from Penelope Ann?
Then read it, sir.
Me, sir?
Of course. You don't suppose I'm going to read a letter from your intended?
My intended? Puff! It's addressed to you. C-O-X.
Do you think that's a C? It looks like a B.
Nonsense. Fracture the seal!
Goodness gracious.
Gracious goodness.
Margate, May the 4th, sir. I hasten to convey to you the intelligence of a melancholy accident, which has bereft you of your intended wife. He means your intended.
Oh, no, yours. However, it's perfectly immaterial. Go on, do go on.
Poor Mrs. Wiggins went for a short excursion in a sailing boat. A sudden and violent squall soon after took place, which, it is supposed, upset her, as she was found, 2 days afterwards, keel upwards.
Poor woman.
The boat, sir. As her man of business, I immediately proceeded to examine her papers, amongst which I soon discovered her will, the following extract from which will, I have no doubt, be satisfactory to you. I hereby bequeath my entire property to my intended husband. Oh, excellent but unhappy creature. Oh,
generous, ill-fated being.
And to think that I tossed up for such a woman.
When I remember that I staked such a treasure on the hazard of a coin toss.
I'm sure, Mr. Box, I can't sufficiently thank you for your sympathy.
And I'm sure, Mr. Cox, you couldn't feel more if she had been your own intended.
If she'd been my intended, she was my own indeed.
Your intended? Oh, come, I like that. Didn't you very properly observe just now so that I proposed to her first?
To which you very sensibly replied that you'd come to an untimely end.
I deny it.
I say you have.
Ooh, the fortune's mine.
Mine!
Stop. A thought strikes me. Instead of going to the law about the property, suppose we divide it?
Equally?
Equally. I'll take 2/3.
That's fair enough. And I'll take 3/4.
That won't do. Half and half.
Agreed. There's my hand upon it.
And mine.
Hello, postman again.
Postman yesterday, postman today.
Another letter, Colonel Cox. Tuppence more.
I forgive you again. Another trifle from Margaret. Goodness gracious.
Gracious goodness.
Happy to inform you, false alarm.
Sudden squall, boat upset, Mrs. Wiggins, your intended.
Picked up by steamboat.
Carried to Boulogne?
Returned here this morning.
Will start by early train tomorrow.
And be with you at 10 o'clock exact.
Oh, no. Oh, Cox, I congratulate you.
Cox, I give you joy.
You'll excuse me, sir, but our last arrangement was that she was your intended.
No, yours. Yours!
Yours! What's that? A cab's drawn up at the door. No, it's a tuppenny omnibus.
A lady's got out.
Ooh, there's no mistake, that majestic person. It's Penelope Ann!
Your intended.
Mr. Cox!
Go away, he's dead! Drown!
Open the door, it's only me, Sergeant Bouncer.
Only you? Then where's the lady?
Gone! And she's left a note for Brigadier Cox.
Put it under. Goodness gracious!
Gracious goodness!
Dear Mr. Cox, pardon my candor, but being convinced that our feelings, like our ages, do not reciprocate, I hasten to apprise you of my immediate union with Mr. Knox! Huzzah!
3 cheers for Knox!
The little second floor back room is quite ready.
I don't want it.
No more do I.
Box.
Cox, you'll excuse the apparent insanity of the remark, but the more I gaze upon your features, the more I'm convinced that you are my long-lost brother.
The very observation I was going to make to you.
Oh, tell me, in mercy tell me, have you such a thing as a strawberry mark on your left arm?
No!
Then it is he!
Between you and me, I'm rather partial to this house.
So am I. I begin to feel quite at home in it.
My hand upon it, join but yours. Agree the house will hold us.
And two good
lodge, let's bounce against, she'll in her arms enfold us.
Oh, yes, yes, to arms, and was alarms. You remember, of course, you remember, of course, when I mounted a horse in Her Majesty's force, as one of the yeomen who'd come with the foemen, for then an invasion threatened the nation.
And there's no occasion to sing.
Rat-a-plan, 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 rat-a-plan.
Yes,
he can.
Rat-a-plan, 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 rat-a-plan.